Hello, Polymer Materials 2. Welcome to your Wednesday's lecture. So we're going to continue on the topic of new polymers and new functions that you probably haven't seen in polymers before. So last time we left off on dielectric elastomers, and so today we're going to talk about dielectric elastomers and electroactive polymers. So this is a really interesting topic because now this topic couples the voltage or current stimulus that you can give with electronics to polymer motion. So you put an electric field across a polymer and then it moves. And that's why we call it electroactive or electroresponsive. And so we'll talk about some of the different polymers that are used in this application and talk about how those polymers work or how polymers respond to these electric fields. So you've seen this before. This is a dielectric thin film. And the key part about all of the samples that we'll talk about today is that you have electrodes, so you have a positive and negative electrode, or an anode and cathode, and then you have an elastomer, or a flexible material, in between those electrodes. So you need a flexible material, of course, because you want the polymer to move, so it has to be flexible, it has to be relatively moderate modulus, but you can design that modulus depending on how you build the network. And so we learned last time about different networks and gels and how we can change their mechanical properties. You can do the same with these dielectric elastomers. So there's some polymers in this section that you may have heard of before, and then I'll introduce some new functions of those. Okay, so here's the nomenclature: electroactive polymers, ionic electroactive polymers, electronic electroactive polymers, and there's a really nice review article here if you're interested in this sort of topic that goes through all these mechanisms. Okay, so these electroactive polymers are really divided into two classes. So they're divided into electronic materials or dielectrics. And so those are things like silicone rubber, things like PVDF, things that don't have any ions moving in the material. And then you can have ionic electroactive polymers, where the ion motion in the material causes the material to move. So we haven't studied a lot of dielectric materials, but those are your garden variety polymers, silicone gels, or other sorts of flexible polymers without any ions in them. But these ionic electroactive polymers are very similar to what we've studied in the ionic conductivity section. Nafion, for instance, does this ionic electroactuation. Polymers filled with ionic liquids like imidazoles or phosphoric acid or other types of ionic solvents will also exhibit ionic electroactive actuation. So you've already seen some of these materials already, and so we're just talking about using these materials in a new context. Okay, so here's the nomenclature. You can look at this chart in the notes, and you can see the different subdivided classes that we have for these sorts of structures. So we have a branch that are electronic responsive, or dielectrics, of course, because polymers are not conducting electricity. They're serving as a dielectric between two electrodes. Or we have these ionic electroactive polymers. And so there you can look at the different attributes of them. All right, so the operation mechanism of these is very simple. So when we charge an electrode, when we charge a positive electrode and a negative electrode, we develop a field across the polymer. So that positive charge and that negative charge act on the polymer, and they act on themselves. Either you get a actuation or a squishing of the material, or something happens inside the polymer. You get ionic motion, or you get dipoles reorienting, and the polymer responds to that. Because, of course, polymers are incompressible fluids or incompressible solids, and so you need to preserve what happens, or you need to preserve the volume. When you squish these electrodes together with a field, the material has to flatten out. And if you're smart about how these are designed, this strain, this electronic-induced strain, or this potential-induced strain, can cause really interesting phenomena inside the materials. All right, so this is just showing an electrostatic or electronic actuator. This has some diagrams for what's happening. And you can see if you look very closely right here, when we turn the potential on, you see that this circle grows a little bit. So you go from this smaller circle to this bigger one right here. And that's not super exciting per se, but if you can build these actuation devices into, or these actuation materials into real devices, you're going to get some very interesting things that happen just by this simple building up of charge on the positive and negative electrode and those charges acting on the polymer. Okay, so these are built out of lots of different materials. So we have some conducting polymer electrodes here, and so you can see the different construction. And if you look up electroactive polymers in the literature, you can find all sorts of things that people have done with putting conducting polymers as electrodes, using ionic liquids like this in the dielectric, making these electrodes, like I said, out of conducting polymers or nanotubes or gold leaf. And so being able to build this electrode, polymer, electrode type structure is really important because this will be mechanically cycled. So you'll undergo cycling of this structure. So you need flexible electrodes, and you also need the electrodes to be pliable enough that allows the polymer to respond. If you put two really stout, thick metal electrodes on each side of the polymer, not a lot's going to happen because the polymer needs to have its flexibility to respond in these sort of environments. Okay, so we can also have this phenomenon called a dipolar actuator, where instead of just a dielectric or electrostatic actuation where you have charge on the electrodes, if you take a polar material or a material with a bunch of dipoles in it and you actuate it, those dipoles can line up and you can get this dipolar type behavior. And you can get larger responses by harnessing these dipoles in the material. So you can imagine that all these dipoles, the way they line up, really enhance the response just compared to this electrostatic actuator. So that's just a different type of actuation mechanism. One really cool demonstration, and I won't show you online here, but it's this. So if you look at Soft Robotics Toolkit and you look at these dielectric elastomers, what they did was they made an elastomer right here that's an ion gel, and when they actuate it, it grew. So you can go back and forth between these two states where now the polymer, and it just so happens to be clear in this case, can expand and contract. And so you can imagine, again, building soft robots out of this material or building advanced mechanical actuators rather than having steel components or motors that turn different devices or actuate your devices. If you have a collection of these actuators, you can make a soft robot that's basically all solid state, and that's very interesting. So I suggest you check out this website. Also in this, what they did is because of this actuation, you can actually make a speaker out of these dielectric elastomers. So speakers, a conventional stereo speaker, just takes an electric signal from wherever it comes from the amplifier, and it oscillates a mechanical cone or oscillates a physical element. That's why speakers vibrate, because sound, of course, is air vibrations. And so if you can oscillate this dielectric elastomer fast enough, you can make a speaker that's perfectly clear, and you can get it to play different sorts of interesting music. And so you can look up this science paper. They have some cool videos, but this is a really creative way to make this clear speaker using dielectric elastomers. And so I suggest you check it out. It's worth it. And you'll notice SWO right here is the person who actually made the super tough hydrogel that we were talking about last time. So he certainly knows something about making gels do what he wants. Okay. So there's a lot of different applications for these electroactive polymers, and so I'm just going to give you some ideas right here in this notes, and you have the notes that you've downloaded from Canvas. So whether you're interested in MEMS or pumps or speakers are all these sorts of applications. People are working on these using dielectric elastomers. These are some relative properties of these materials. If you're interested in the comparison of electroactive transducers and non-polymer type transducers. And so people are interested in characterizing the efficiency, so the conversion from electrical energy into mechanical work. People are interested in looking at the strain and pressure that these can overcome, what the elastic energy is, what the maximum frequency or what the cycle speed is. So you can take a look at this table in the notes and familiarize yourself with what's out there. Now, there aren't many dielectric elastomers that are commercialized, but it's certainly a big research area, and electroactive polymers is a really important part of responsive materials or active materials, getting materials to move under electrical stimulus. So this is similar to the piezoelectric effect, although that's a very specific mechanism in piezoelectric materials. But we've had piezoelectrics for a long time, and now we're bringing that into the soft materials domain where we can get polymers and other soft materials to respond to these electrical signals. Or vice versa. Say if you have a sensor, you have a carpet that's built out of one of these electroactive polymers, and you step on that carpet could send an electrical signal saying, ah, someone has stepped on me. And so you can use these electroactive polymers in two modes. You can apply an electric current and they'll change the shape. Or if you squeeze on these things and change their shape, change the distance between electrodes, they can generate an electrical signal. So you can look up energy harvesting with electroactive polymers and other unique applications of these materials. Okay, and here's some references from the previous table. You have those in the notes, so you can go look stuff up if you need to. All right, this is just one more demonstration, so showing voltage on versus voltage off. We can get these polymers to change shape, and the idea is to just have enough flexibility in the electrodes where you can get these things to undergo macroscopic strain, because of course we want changes that are technologically important. Okay, and so basically using acrylic elastomers or using silicones, you can get an idea of what the properties are based on that previous diagram. So part of this field is connecting the mechanical properties of the material to whatever response they have in the application. So for an acrylic elastomer, if we look carefully at this table, you notice that acrylic elastomers are dipoles, so you can look up what acrylates are, but they have an ester in the backbone, and that ester is polar, and you see that the elastic energy is a lot higher. So we can compare silicones, which are pretty nonpolar, to more polar polymers, and we can compare the response of those materials and figure out how to try and build a molecular structure that makes sense for whatever application we're interested in. All right, and so there's all sorts of different geometries. So we can have bimorphs, we can have extensional units, we can make pumps, we can make tubes. So there's all sorts of different geometries, and some mechanical engineers do a lot in this field, coming up with really interesting ways to actuate devices. So this is one cool one right here. So this is a rolled up dielectric elastomer. And what they did was they made these actuators, and these linear actuators will expand and contract depending on the signal. And so they use those linear actuators to make this little robot insect right there. And instead of using linear actuators or other type of mechanical units, they use these electroactive polymers to help this thing walk around. So this is cool because electroactive polymers have no moving parts. They can be very light. You don't have any very expensive valves or linear actuators, things that you need to make those work in a mechanical sense. But these polymer actuators could take the place, especially in very small and light robotics. So you can check out that if you're interested. Another place where this works is artificial muscles. And so people have talked about actuating various pumps and other sorts of devices using this concept, where now, just like the muscle that you have in your body, it's soft, you can shape it in different ways, and then when you apply a stimulus to that muscle, it will tighten up and it will move whatever component you want. And so this idea of artificial muscles out of soft materials is a really big area that you can look up some more information on if you want. And what's cool about this slide is that this is an autofocus lens positioner, but there's a company called Artificial Muscles Incorporated. So people are actively working on these types of technologies, and this is really sci-fi applications of the polymers that we've studied in this class. So if you go on to graduate school, or if you go work for a high-tech company, or you go work for one of these companies looking at advanced applications, you might run into these electroactive polymers. Another area that people are using these electroactive polymers in are braille devices, or dynamic braille devices. So this is a braille device right here. The little dots pop up and down to give different braille signals, so people, blind people can read this active braille. And these machines are really expensive. All those little mechanical actuators are very fragile. They cost a lot of money. And so computer braille devices need to become cheaper. They need to become lighter and more portable, so blind people have this reading device that they can carry around with them, just like a Kindle. And so people are using electroactive polymers for these braille devices right here. So this is one example here. I think I have another example. Oh, no, I don't have another example. But this shows that you can build some really interesting structures with these linear actuators. And what happens in this device is those little dots are just small little tubes like I showed on the mechanical insect. And so those dots will pop up and down depending on the electrical stimulus applied. And in this case, they're using PVDF, which is a ferroelectric polymer. And Professor Ching Wong in our department works a lot on these ferroelectric polymers, and he's published some really interesting papers. And so if you're interested in those sort of ferroelectric or bipolar polymers, you can go chat with Ching. All right, so you can make bimorphs out of these as well, and bimorphs are just basically devices that will bend to one side. And so you can see as a potential is increased in this PVDF bimorph. So here's the potential or the voltage down here. You can see the displacement. And so with 100 or a few hundred volts, you can get displacements on the order of millimeters. There's a video of this that I suggest you check out. You have the link in the notes. And so you can take a look at this polymer actuating in terms of, or in response to an applied electric field. So imagine your windshield wipers, instead of mechanically moving them back and forth, you just have polymer windshield wipers that are actuators that sweep back and forth. So if you need to clean solar cells, or you need to clean the surface of satellites, or need to clean the lenses of telescopes, perhaps these electroactive polymers are a way to do that. Here's PVDF. It's ferroelectric, and so you can read more about PVDF and why it's a bipolar polymer, but basically in a certain crystal polymorph of PVDF, you can get this dipolar nature. So in the beta phase of PVDF compared to the alpha phase, and you all know what PVDF is, so this beta phase is polar because we have a strong dipole due to the fluorine's electron withdrawing in the chain. And so because of that beta phase, PVDF shows these very special properties. Okay, and so what that looks like, or what that can look like, either in semicrystalline polymers or in liquid crystals, is like this. So we can build in these responsive units that respond to an electric field and make the material respond in terms of an applied voltage. So there are lots of different strategies in order to accomplish this actuation of polymers with an electric field or with a voltage. All right, so that's all about the dielectric elastomers. The other thing that we'll talk about is these ionic electroactuators. So you see this diagram right here where we have cation-rich clusters, we have a polymer, and we have an anode and cathode. And so what this slide tells us about is as we put a potential across the electrodes, so we have delta V across the electrodes, when we put a potential across the electrodes, the cations go one way in the material, the anions go the other way in a material, so rather than just building up charge at the interface like an electrostatic actuator, if we have ions and mobile ions in the material, like in Nafion or like in our other ion conductors that we studied, as soon as you put a potential across those electrodes, the ions move. And because the ions are different sizes and move at different rates, when they move to one side of the material, you get bending of that material right here. So this plot shows that you get cation migration to one interface. Now there's more ions on this surface than there are on this surface, and that's what causes the bending. So if we put more volume here, we get bending and we get actuation of this material. And you get some electrostatic repulsion and other things going on at long times here, but this idea that you can move ions across the material and induce a volume change is how these ionic electroactive polymers work. So from this lecture, you should be able to explain the difference between electrostatic or dielectric actuators and ionic electroactive polymers. And so these undergo some high strains as well. So this can be a piece of Nafion with gold leaf electrodes or an ionic liquid-filled polymer with nanotube electrodes, and so you can see the really high strains that these undergo. And this is interesting because the potentials can be pretty low. So this positive and negative potential here, it doesn't take very many volts in order to get ions to move in a material. So these can respond at, let's say, 1 volt to 3 volts. Whereas you noticed in PVDF actuators, you needed hundreds of volts in order to get those dipoles to start to move in the material. So ionic actuators can be interesting because you don't need very high potentials in order to get them to move. So this is just a nice web page on these things. And so here's a schematic of what one of these ionic electroactive polymers looks like. So you have electrodes, you have ions, you apply the potential, the ions move to one side, and of course if you make more ions at one interface than the other, you get this curving of the material right here. So make sure you know that mechanism in comparison to the electrostatic actuators. Same thing right here. So in this case, what Moon Park did is she used a polystyrene polymethylbutylene matrix. So we've seen that polymer. You can look up this Nature Communication paper. So that's a sulfonated polymer, and she puts ionic liquid in that sulfonated polymer, and then she gets ionic electroactive actuation when the potential is on. So this idea of moving ions around, it's not only good for electrolytes, but perhaps we can use it in advanced robotics and advanced actuators. So this is some work from Penn State, actually, and others, where they're using electrodes, silver electrodes in this case, along with nanotubes, and a piece of Nafion. So they show the construction where you have nanotube electrodes and these conductive surfaces. You have your ionic polymer in the middle. And so these papers are about building high-performance electrodes for these devices. Because you can imagine the polymers can certainly bend. They can deform however they want. But getting charges on the surface of this polymer can be difficult. So you need high-conductivity electrodes. You need high surface area. And so in this case, they're using carbon nanotubes or gold nanoparticles. And so these papers are about trying to build really good electrodes, and then they put a layer of silver on the top to make sure everything's connected. So that's something to take a look at. Building these structures is an important part of this field. So here's some device performance showing the oscillation time and displacement. So you can see these will cycle back and forth, back and forth. And so you can get these characteristic curves. Not only do they make good videos, but you can characterize the motion in response to an applied field or an applied load. And there's all sorts of interesting types of things that are reported in the literature, and I've given you the reference right here. Okay, so there's a lot of cool videos in this lecture. I encourage you to check out the links. Here's a couple more right here, so you have the notes in class. And so think about how the molecular structure of the polymer, whether it's dielectric, whether it's polar, whether it's nonpolar, how flexible it is, whether it's ionic, how the chemical structure of the polymer might play a role in the performance of these devices. And why, the question is, why do polymers respond to these electric fields? When you put a charge on a polymer, what happens to it? And so that's the origin of some of these advanced applications in electroactive polymers. Thank you very much. You'll have a new video on Friday, and I will be in town for the last week of class next week. So if you're concerned about your grade or concerned about how class is going, please make an appointment to see me, and we can either sort it out by email or we'll be able to sort it out in person in the last week of class. Don't forget your video assignment. Make sure you're making good progress on that, and I look forward to seeing them on the last day of class next week. Thank you very much. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.